neighborhood was afraid of him. Even the gangsters in the neighborhood were afraid of him because he was just out of control. And so this then helped me. Now, am I saying to you that you should threaten your children like that? I am not saying that. I'm saying this, it worked for me. Now, today, these children today, I don't know, you have to many times do all kinds of things. But the best thing to do is to train them up in what? The way that they should go. And when they are old, what will happen? Praise the Lord. Train up a child in what? The way they should go. The scripture says, and when they are old, they should not depart. And then another scripture says, beat your child and deliver his soul from hell. And this even is becoming something that is going to ultimately be outlawed if the rules of the National Child Rights Commission are approved. It will become a felony if you discipline your children. This is now being considered by the Obama administration as these things are presented to the United Nations. And they're pushing for children's rights. And to the extent that you can no longer have anything to do with discipline with your children if they pass this stuff. But back to the scripture now. It is good for a man what? It's good for a man not to touch a woman. Because if he will respect these boundaries, he and will not get himself in trouble. They wrote the question. They wrote posing the question to the Apostle Paul about whether or not it was appropriate to be dating and to be socializing on a level in which the individuals in the church would actually be having physical contact. So now he's addressing them. When you ask the question, it is good for a man not to what? Touch a woman. It is best not to have contact. Why? Verse number 2. Nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, not someone else's. Read. And let every woman have her own husband. Turn to someone and say, not someone else's. And this is to avoid fornication, which means every unlawful sexual indulgence. Come in and join us, young man. And certainly your mother is happy, grandmother's happy that you're here. All right? So this then would be how it is. This is what he is answering. He's answering their question. They ask the question. He's bringing the answers. If you want to do it right, touch someone and say, if you want to do it right, you have to have your own husband. And you have to have your own wife. And then once you have these things, then these things mean that your wife is exclusively yours and your husband is exclusively yours. Can the church say amen? All right. Then verse number 4, read. The wife have not power over her own body, but the husband. That simply means she cannot give her body to anyone but her husband. That's simply what it means. It means she does not have her body. Now, if she was single, she can make the choice that she would, in fact, give her body to the man she chooses to marry. But if, in fact, she is married, she has already made that choice. So now her body only and exclusively is the property of her husband. Now, someone said, I thought this said that the body and the spirit belongs to God. Well, yes, it belongs to God. That's why he can tell you what the boundaries are. That's why he can tell me what the boundaries are, because once we're saved, then our bodies belong to who? God. And God says the only one that you can give your body to in terms of sexuality is your wife or your... Turn to someone and say, it is as simple as that. Now, they are studying at the University of Michigan. They're talking about trying to redefine marriage. And they're saying that they're going to, after their research, their findings are supposed to draw certain conclusions. And with those conclusions, Sister Samika, is that marriage can be whatever individuals think it is. So if three people want to get together and say we're married, we all share each other in sexuality, or four people, or five, or if two women and maybe one man or two men and one woman, or four people, two men and two women, want to all be married to each other. And they just all climb on top of each other, I guess. They're going to break the bed down, that's for sure. Can we say amen? But this is actually, literally, what they're trying to do. And they are looking to issue these ridiculous and ludicrous and ungodly and filthy findings at some time in the future. Because most certainly, they will have their way if God doesn't stop them. And they will do whatever it is that they're determined to do if God does not intervene. And we are in, someone say, we are in the last days. So now, verse number 3, read, let the husband render unto the wife due benevolence. That it means due, that means in so many words, her due in sexuality. Do not hold back. If you have the ability to do so, do not hold back. Can we say amen? And so as Bishop Paddock used to say, you cannot have a perpetual headache, an eternal headache. You're married for 20 years and every night you have a headache. You've been having headaches for 20 years, migraines. That's not going to work. Can we say amen? Because you do have obligations in the relationship. Now, if you have physical problems, then you have to take that up with you, your spouse, and your doctor. I'm not getting into that. Because people do have physical problems. Well, someone said Viagra, Levitra, or whatever it is. I don't know. Cialis. I mean, these are all these medications that people are taking. I see these things as a problem in this respect, because sometimes if people would get saved and walk with God and stop fornicating, and then they become incapacitated, which God now has blessed them where they do not have the ability to go out and continue fornicating. But they are so determined to do it, they go get some prescription medication so they can continue to do it anyway. And some of them buy it on the black market. Isn't that true? So this is simply a determination of the flesh to violate the laws of God, because there is the law of sin that is where? In our members. And the members of the natural body, when not governed by the Holy Spirit, must commit sin and will, trust me, will commit sin. This is what sinners do. Sinners do what? But not turn to someone and say, this is not us. So let the husband render unto the wife what? Due benevolence. And husbands, don't have a perpetual headache either. Or you know what your problem would be. Can we say amen? Read, and likewise also the wife unto the husband. Do not starve your spouse sexually. Now, some do it, and they do it deliberately. And they should understand that they are in violation of the Word of God. Now, some do not have the capacity to do so. And then as a district elder put it many years ago, a marriage is more than sexuality. There's far much more than marriage than the bedroom. And so then if you're married and you have these complications, then you have to make it work. Can we say amen? All right, verse number 4. The wife have not power over her own body, but the husband. And likewise, also the husband have not power of his own body, but the wife. That simply means the wife's body belongs to her husband. That's the only man she can give her body to. And the husband's body belongs to the wife, and that's the only woman that he can give his body to without being in fornication or involved in some unlawful sexual indulgence. Can the church say amen? Now don't look at me funny. This is clearly what the scripture teaches. Can the church say amen? All right, verse 5. Defraud ye not one the other, except it be with consent for a time, that ye may give yourselves to fasting and prayer, and come together again, that Satan tempt you not for your incontinency. And your incontinency means where your failure to render unto each other the due benevolence that you're required to do so. So defrauding means when you're responsible in your